like to introduce our speaker at the present at this time. We have, as you saw by your newsletter, our program this evening is going to be Hillbilly Facts and Myths. And I encourage you in the newsletter to come and find out what a hillbilly is if you don't know what one is. And if you are a hillbilly, maybe you can find your identity. If you didn't know what you were supposed to be, maybe you'll find out whether you fit the category or not. I facetiously said in the newsletter also that for the true hillbillies in the group, we might doubt what a college professor from the big city might be able to tell us about hillbillies. But I did assure you that our speaker does have credentials that qualify him to speak on this subject. Dr. Holliday is a professor of English at SMSU, and he's been in that position since 1966. He is a Hollister, Missouri native and a graduate of Drury College with an AB degree in philosophy and English. He holds the MA degree in English from the University of Arkansas and a PhD in American Studies from the University of Minnesota, Minneapolis. So he holds membership in the American Folklore Society and is the founder of the Ozark State Folklore Society. And I didn't ask him to say much about that this evening, but I would like to know a little bit more about that. So perhaps during your remarks tonight, Dr. Holliday, you can share with us something about that society. He's also a member of the National Conference of Teachers of English and the American Studies Association, American Association of University Professors. So I present to you this evening Dr. Holliday to talk to us about hillbillies.
I asked Mr. Barnett a few minutes ago how long I should talk. He told me, I'm usually out of here by 8 o'clock. I always figure that as a preacher can hold a group 15 minutes before they go to the Heritage Cafeteria.
Yeah.
I ought to be able to hold them for an hour after they get through there. I was asked by a reporter some months ago, kind of by chance, I think, about hillbilly things of some kind, and I, while I was preparing material for a graduate seminar on Jewish American literature, later she called me and interviewed me by telephone for somewhere between 2 and 3 hours. That was the origin of that article that appeared in the Springfield paper sometime last year, I guess. And I presume it's the origin of my being asked here. I am an Ozark hillbilly, and that's my primary claim to credentials for being here. They don't get much in the way of credentials as a hillbilly at Drury, at least he didn't back in the early 60s, or at the University of Arkansas even, or the University of Minnesota, certainly not. The idea that I'm from Hollister, well, that's where I went to school, that's where I graduated from school, but I started school at Pine Top. You know where that is? Nobody else does either. Except, I don't know, a few Holidays, Snowdens, a few others. My dad and my grandfather were born at Oasis. You know where that is? Or was? You know where it was? Before those fellas ruined the whole dad-burned country, flooded it permanently to control occasional. Um, Well, there are a lot of, in that interview for the newspaper, I talked about a number of things that I consider myth and fact, and a lot of those things you're probably familiar with. You were familiar with probably before you ever read that article in the newspaper, if you read it. If you read it, it was probably because of the young woman who wrote the article and not because of the information I gave her. Maybe. There are a number of myths about Ozark hillbillies. One of them is just who is an Ozark hillbilly, or even where is the Ozark? I used to know some people in Kansas City, I guess I still know them, who talked about going down into the Ozarks, like it was off down yonder somewhere. That you had to make a journey to get there from Kansas City. And I know lots of people in St. Louis just turn this thing off. Well, it has its own way of going on and off, I guess.
I'm behind you. I'm trying to get the music off. I'm sorry.
Thank you. I go with
the grapple. What was I talking about?
Kansas City.
I know a lot of people from St. Louis who come down here to Silver Dollar City and places like that to the Ozarks too. But there's a kind of a myth about where the Ozarks is. It's off down yonder in the holler somewhere, but nobody seems to know quite where. Part of the problem there is just what do you use to define it? The Ozarks as a place is a geological formation, and you can take that as one kind of definition of Ozarks and come up with some kind of a definition of Ozarkers. And the Ozarks as a place runs the western end of it, runs from the county of which Tulsa, Oklahoma is the county seat, angles northeastward and crosses the Missouri River at points, a couple of points. Generally, however, follows the Missouri River into St. Louis County. Generally follows the Mississippi River down to about St. Genevieve, Cape Girardeau area, and crosses the Mississippi River and scoops up and, you know, slices off a chunk of southern Illinois. Angles back across the river and follows what's known as Crowley's Ridge in a southwest direction to the Arkansas River, and then thence back toward Tulsa. Roughly, the southern 60% of the state of Missouri and the northern third of Arkansas, a little corner of Kansas, and about a third of Oklahoma, and a little bitty piece of Illinois over there. Now, if you use that definition as everybody inside that boundary is an Ozark hillbilly, you can make some people mad. Because there are an awful lot of rather prosperous German farmers up and down the Mississippi River and the Missouri River, people who built farms and laid them out based on very strict geometrical patterns. They're painted perfectly. Every barn's got 12, 14 lightning rods on top of it. Everything's neat, well laid out. Those people don't know they're Ozark hillbillies. And they don't want to either. Well, there are a lot of other people inside that area too. Are people in Springfield, the city, the queen city of the Ozarks, or are they Ozark hillbillies? I guess that brings up the question, is an Ozarker a hillbilly? Or are they one and the same thing? Well, not necessarily. But the origin of place, the myth of place. Where is the Ozarks? I think an awful lot of people somewhere else and right here have a kind of a vague notion of where the Ozarks or the Ozarks are or is, and nobody's ever been able to figure out whether that verb ought to be are or is either. Is the Ozarks plural or singular?
Well, as a matter of fact, there are an awful lot of different people in the Ozarks. That different kinds of people. That's another myth in itself, a kind of myth of origins. Who are Ozark hillbillies? Scotch-Irish people, huh? Those people out of Ireland and Scotland never reached by the Renaissance, who somehow made it across the Atlantic Ocean and ended up in these hills. That's largely true, but those German farmers, again, up and down the Mississippi River and Missouri River, out in Cedar County, and all up and down, you know, Highway 7, Drive 71 from Joplin to Kansas City. Now, you get out of the Ozarks, not too far north of there, but you can run east from there, northeast toward Clinton and on east. There are an awful lot of German farmers in the western part of Missouri. Scotch-Irish, yeah. There's a little town down in Arkansas, not far from Fayetteville, named Taunty Town. They grow a lot of grapes around there. Most of them now, almost all of them now, go to the Welch Grape Company, and they're made into grape juice and grape jelly. But those people around Taunty Town, an acquaintance of mine retired from Chicago. He was a newspaperman, retired to the Fayetteville area, bought a little farm. He had 28 acres of grapes. One year, his grapes won the Grape Growers Association Award for the best grape harvest that year. The man's name was Cheadle, C-H-E-A-D-L-E, just about as English as you can get a name to be. The president of the Grape Growers Association presented the award, however, and it was so far from his mind that any Englishman might ever win the Grape Growers Award that he called him Mr. Chidele. Taunty Town is an Italian settlement. There are numerous examples like that. The county in which the capital of Arkansas is located is the same one that Fort Leonard Wood is located in, except in different states. Now, Pulaski County. That sound like a good Scotch-Irish name to you? Pulaski? No. Good Polish name. Origins. There are a lot of different people, and you can pursue that in that idea of the myth of origins in two or three different ways. Who are the people who came to the Ozarks, and how did they get here? I think everybody I've ever heard talk about, my people, they came from Tennessee and Kentucky, came across the mountains. An awful lot of Scotch-Irish people came from there. Most of them came from southern Pennsylvania or West Virginia before that, because mostly that was kind of the second step in the route of migration westward, Tennessee and Kentucky was. The third one was the Ozarks. Something of a little known fact, however, is that one of the major ports of entry for immigrants in the last part of the 19th century and on into the early 20th century, immigrants into the Ozarks, was the port of New Orleans. And up the Mississippi River, and up the Red River, and up the White River, and on points north and northwest. There were four little towns settled over, starting on the Mississippi River, and running west. Four little towns in a row settled by, there are five shiploads of five chartered ships left Germany to come to the Missouri Ozarks to establish the Utopian Society. And one of the ships was lost on the way, but those four ships came, four little towns, starting on the Mississippi River with Wittenberg and Altenberg and Fredonia, is that it? The fourth one over, which is over close to where Interstate 55 is now, they changed their name during the Civil War to Uniontown. to let those guys coming from the north know, hey, don't you, we're Union. And there, those four little towns in a row there, all German origin, in the middle of them, a German academy, a college, for the education of the young. The Port of New Orleans was a large, point of origin for many people in the Ozarks. It is not a myth that people came from Tennessee and Kentucky into the Ozarks. It's just, there just isn't quite enough knowledge about where they came from. Family that I know of down by Monette moved to the Ozarks, moved to the Monette area, they were farmers, from Ohio in two boxcars. They loaded up their farm implements and their farm goods into two boxcars and they moved west. I thought people went west in covered wagons. They did, and they walked, and they rode horses, and they rode railroads, and everything else. As soon as that railroad went anywhere, they abandoned those covered wagons. Just exactly the same way some of you might have, well, as soon as automobiles became available, cheap enough, you got one, because they beat the stuffing out of the horse. Especially if you got a family and pulling a wagon down. Anybody who has ever sat in the bottom of a wagon and gone over Ozark roads has had just about all he wants of it right there at that point. If you've never done it, what can we use for an analogy? There are all kinds of myths of identity. In addition to this, the origins and place, or perhaps misunderstandings, oversimplifications, and so on. The myth of identity, I think, is one that has to be identified more as stereotype, perhaps, than myth. Now, myth, as I'm using it here, is merely a widely held belief, in the cultural character, cultural characterization, cultural attitudes, this kind of thing. There are other distinctly different definitions of myth, but the myth of the Ozark hillbilly, the hillbilly character is one that there are still a lot of people around the United States, some here in Springfield and elsewhere around the Ozarks, who believe the Ozark hillbilly does exist and has existed just exactly as he is stereotypically projected for commercial reasons by a lot of people in the Ozarks, from the colonial bread company who sells hillbilly bread to Silver Dollar City to the Shepherd of the Hills farm to an awful lot of other places up and down the road and around the lakes and so on, because a hillbilly is worth a lot of money. Jed Clampett was worth a lot of money. Not because he struck oil in Texas or somewhere, wherever they had oil down there, but because he, as the show went on, he was kind of redefined as an Ozark hillbilly. The Beverly Hillbillies. It was based on a stereotype that is supposed to characterize a lot of people in the Ozarks. Now, stereotypes are big generalizations based on a little bit of truth and a lot of rubber bands or something like that. But there is truth in stereotypes. They grow from fact. And they aren't made up of all air, there is a little fact there, of all stereotypes. The problem with them is that they're taken as the whole truth for all the people all the time, and that won't work. Characters, are those really supposed to be like? Those are really supposed to be insane. Whiskey drinking, gun burst and see his neck. So, completely illiterate, sexually undisciplined, not promiscuous necessarily, just not quite bright enough to know what he's supposed to do with it. Just undisciplined. Try to get his to sleep work. There is no myth in the fact that Ozark people who have lived in the hill sections, the rough hilly sections of the Ozark, there's no myth that they have been poor. It is no myth that they have not been as progressive as other Americans. It is no myth that they have not been a myth. They are just trying to twist it up from the almost all, I'm talking about 95% or better,
Ozark as I've ever known. Worked and worked and worked. Men and women and children all worked, and they did everything possible to make things just as good as they possibly could, to make things just as comfortable as they possibly could. But if you've ever dug a hole in an Ozark hillside to plant anything in or to put a post hole in or anything else, you know that that's just not the most promising farmland in the world. And there is some good farmland in the Ozarks. There are a few spots of prairie left, and there are some river bottoms here and there, but we are talking about a little bit of land there. Most of the Ozarks is that where you start to dig a post hole. One of these kind of post hole diggers is useless. You got to have a pick and a shovel and a big crowbar. Big one. That's the idea of the deliberately unprogressive and backward Ozark hillbilly is one characteristic of the Ozark hillbilly that I find based on almost no fact at all, except the fact that he lives in a place where you just can't do much. You can live, if you work hard enough, and live rather comfortably by Ozark standards, but not by standards out there. I grew up on a farm where we milked cows, and we had beef cows, and we had hogs, and we had about a 4-acre tobacco allotment. My family came out of southern Pennsylvania, tobacco-growing country, into the Long Creek Valley, where there was a fairly large tobacco-growing community. Tobacco was marketable because you could haul, you could haul in a pickup or in a truck a lot of tobacco. One 2.5-ton truck, you could haul the entire tobacco output of about 4, 5, or 6 different farms, all the way to Louisville, Shelbyville, Kentucky, or to Weston, Missouri. Those were the two nearest market points for tobacco. That's rather typical of Ozark markets. They have not been accessible. Springfield was a long way off. The WPA during the 1930s did an awful lot to make a lot of places accessible. They built an awful lot of those rock bridges across an awful lot of those little hollers. And they wore out a lot of mules and a lot of dirt slips, making road cuts where there had been almost no roads before. That's the 1930s. And there wasn't a lot of progress and a lot of different things between the 1930s and the 1940s. So there's an awful lot of material here that I find an awful lot of stereotypical material, an awful lot of myth about Ozark hillbilly. It is profitable nowadays to maintain that in certain ways. The Ozarks, however, is no longer, the large parts of the Ozarks, is no longer an unprofitable place. Silver Dollar City and Shepherd Eagles Farm are not unprofitable by any means. Probably the most productive crop ever reared in the Ozarks are those signs that line the highways. The most profitable crops are those raised by sign builders and sign painters illustrating hillbilly things. In the last few weeks, I've noticed on television, in this case, not along the sides of the road, you can cure, and there's a new kind of mythology growing, because the nature of the Ozarks has changed. the Ozarks is no longer a place where ignorant people live, no longer the place where sloth or lazy people, sexually ignorant, illiterate, or marginal illiterate, deliberately backward people live. Now it's a place, come to the serenity of the Ozarks and cure your alcoholism. Come to the, no, to the fresh air and the green of the Ozarks. I have some questions about that kind of advertising, but that's part of the fact of the Ozarks. That's part of the reason a lot of people have been in the Ozarks. In the area where I grew up, there were a number of people who were migrant workers. They were Ozarkers who went to California about 5 or 6 months of the year to work and make enough money so they could come back to the Ozarks and stay the rest of the year, where they made no money at all. But they wouldn't stay out there where they could make money, most of them. They kept coming back. An awful lot of Ozark young people have left. They've gone away. And some of them stayed until they reached retirement age before they came back. And an awful lot of them stayed a year or two or three and couldn't take it no more. And they came back. This air and this something about the Ozarks that a lot of people have come to the Ozarks. Those immigrants coming out of southern Pennsylvania, out of Tennessee and Kentucky were not so ignorant. They didn't recognize sorry farmland when they saw it. They knew where they were moving, but they moved there anyway. An awful lot of the best land throughout the United States had been taken up. Ozark immigration, Ozark homesteading lasted well up into the 20th century in some ways. Settling in the Ozarks was a kind of a backwash. But after the Civil War, an awful lot of Union soldiers exercised their veterans' rights and claimed land in the Ozarks. An awful lot of them. Because they came here and they liked it. And they stayed. No. And one last kind of myth I want to talk about, the idea of the myth of the kind of insensitive and ignorant and illiterate Ozarkans. Some of the finest poetry I've ever heard or heard of, I've heard in the Ozarks. Incidentally, Herman Melville, a great American author, wrote it before. Those of you who don't know, just a footnote, irrelevant to everything else I've said. Herman Melville wrote a poem about General Nathaniel Lyon's death at Wilson's Creek. Dr. Northrup over at SMS talks about, well, he gets around some also for a college professor. He talks about sitting out there on the hillside with a bunch of fox hunters and listening to them talk. And he tells of one time sitting there listening, and this illiterate hillbilly sitting there listening with his eyes almost shut. Oh, Blue, she'll run the dark right out of night. And that's about as poetic as you can get. Now, Ozarkers may be literate in some ways also that other people don't know about. They may be ignorant in some ways that people don't know about, ways that I don't know about. But frankly, Ozarkers are not any different, have not been any different from people elsewhere. They have done everything they could with what they had to work with. In many instances, they didn't have a lot to work with. but they came to the land that they liked, and they stayed. They came because they liked it, and they stayed long enough until it became home. And then all of those Ozarkers that you couldn't ride out here with the Union Army. And an awful lot of the Union Army tried to drive an awful lot of people out. And then the Union Army came in and settled. I'm going to just stop at that point. If you have questions or comments that you'd like to make, questions you'd like to ask, comments you'd like to make, I'll respond as I can. I had another topic on my mind tonight that I want to talk about. If you want me to just take off on that, it's about 45 minutes too. I'll probably start.
Well, thank
you.
Thank you, Dr. Holliday, for sharing with us this interesting subject and giving us something to think about this evening. I believe we have no other business that we need to take.
Come Christmas time, I usually get about $50 a piece for them.
Okay, well, how big were your trees?
It's about 8 foot, 6 to 8 foot.
Oh, my Lord.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Do you know what kind of herbicide you use? Because most herbicides don't kill pines.
It's whatever it was in that bulletin. I don't know what you'd said in there.
But I never said herbicide.
Well, I took it down to the co-op, and they gave me what they thought was right.
Oh, my Lord.
I got about $6,000 in lost income I'm going to have to try to make up. And I'm retired. I supplement it with, you know, guiding fishing trips here and there from time to time. But.
Sure.
If you just make me out a check, I guarantee you, I just forget the whole thing.
Okay, well, wait a minute. Okay, first place, we are a nonprofit organization of woodland owners, okay? And we our main purpose is protection of private property rights and education of woodland owners so people don't make mistakes like you just made. And I take it you're not a member.
Well, my main purpose is to try to keep, you know, everything afloat here and keep my family, you know, took care of.
Oh, well, sure. I understand that, Mr. Mercer.
Yeah, we ain't going to have any Christmas money this year.
Mr. Mercer, if you read that
bulletin...
I'll
probably get my wife have to braid a lock of her hair into a watch fob for me.
What?
Well, I guarantee you we'd have to make crafts or something because we ain't got no money to buy no presents or won't when it comes time.
Oh, listen, I'm sorry. I don't mean to laugh, but I cannot envision anyone... spraying an acre of pines with herbicide and expecting that to kill the Ips beetle.
Well,
okay?
can you envision an ass whooping? Because that's what it's going to come down to if I don't get some satisfaction out of this thing.
Okay, now hold it, Jack. You don't know who you're talking to.
Well, I ain't usually one to whoop a woman's ass, but my wife...
Oh, well, don't let that get in your way.
My wife's pretty tore up about it. I might send her down there.
Go ahead. You'd never find me. I'm down in the Kiamichi Mountains, but I'll tell you what, you give me your address, and I'll meet you at the damn gate.
By God. You give me your address, and I'll send her down there.
Well,
with about a truckload full
will,
of...
and I'll tell you what, I'll do more than that. She'd never be able to find it. I'll meet her up on the damn highway.
Well,
now,
by
listen.
God, when? When can you be there?
You just pack yourself a lunch and come on down. I'll wait for you.
She'll be down there. I'd probably have to drive her.
Look, all right, wait a minute. Okay, let's talk about this rationally. You've got an acre of trees that you sprayed with herbicide that are dead, okay?
That's what it looks like. They're brown.
Right. All right. I don't know why you sprayed them with herbicide because the bulletin... I didn't say that. I said...
Listen, if you just make me out a check about $6,000, I believe that just about pay my student loan off. You could make it out to Martin Nelson if you would.
What?
He'd pay his student loan off old Mark Nelson. He'd pay his
Your
loan.
Son's
Mark
pulling,
Nelson's my son.
He's pulling the joke on you.
Lord of mercy.
Pat.
What?
It's a joke!
Pat, this is Phil and Brett and Roy Mercer from up here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. How are you?
Yeah!
Are you rat?
Oh, pack a lunch, Pat, and come whoop her ass!
Oh, you darn right I was gonna. I tell you what, I can lift a 50-pound feed bag now with no problem, so I can take anybody. Hey,
believe me, Pat, we don't want to tangle with you.
I guarantee you, we're quivering in our wading boots right now.
I'll tell you what.
In fact,
Mark Nelson
little...
better be quivering. I'm going to whip somebody's butt for sure when I catch
now,
up with that boy.
How? What the hell's he going to school for that's costing him $6,000?
Well, he went to TU.
Well, so what, he go about 2 weeks?
Yeah. Well, he darn sure won't be able to go anywhere for a while when I catch up with him. I don't believe this.
Oh, my Lord. Jangle fist, jangle fist, jangle all the way. Get your fist to fly and have a happy holiday. Hey! Jangle fist, jangle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to whoop some ass on Christmas Day. I dash into the mall, I found a parking place. But then I seen a faster car had jumped right in my space. I think he shocked himself how fast he could vamoose when I jumped out from behind the wheel and knocked both his lungs loose. Oh, jangle fist, jangle all the way. Get your fist to fly and end them shopping woes today. Hey, jangle fist, jangle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to whoop some ass on Christmas Day. I went into the store to get my money back. On a Christmas choo-choo train, it wouldn't stay on the track. They said their policy was to make an exchange instead. So I reached over there and exchanged that train for some pop knots on their heads. Oh, jangle fist, jangle all the way. Get your fist to fly and end them shopping woes today. Hey, jangle fist, jangle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to whoop some ass on Christmas Day. A day or two ago, I found a Christmas tree. I grabbed it up, but some old boy had grabbed same time as me. He wouldn't let it go, but quite to his surprise, how soon he loosened up his grip when I dotted both his eyes. Oh, jangle fist, jangle all the way. Get your fist to fly and have a happy holiday. Hey, jangle fist, jangle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to whoop some ass on Christmas.